Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Jo Butterfield, an instructor and the academic advisor for the Undergraduate Certificate in Human Rights at the University of Iowa Center for Human Rights. I'm also an adjunct assistant professor in the UI Department of History. UICHR is housed in the College of Law, but our work is interdisciplinary. Throughout its nearly 25-year existence, UICHR has been committed to both educating members of the campus and broader community about human rights challenges, and to creating a space for conversations around exploring and developing, via a human rights lens, concrete solutions to the most pressing problems we face. I'm here today to launch the second webinar in the Center's fall programming series, Human Rights and Reproductive Justice. The concept of reproductive justice is grounded in fundamental, internationally recognized human rights, such as the right to health, the right to information, the right to privacy, the right to decide on the number and spacing of children, the right to found a family, the right to adequate food, clothing, and housing, the right to be free from discrimination, and more. We began the fall series by examining the complexity of factors that impact the ability to parent. You can watch this webinar on the Center's YouTube channel. We continue the series today by exploring the ability to gain access to reproductive care. The series will then turn to considering the factors that drive outcome disparities in reproductive care, and we'll conclude with a webinar that explores how advocates are working to promote and protect human rights in order to attain reproductive justice. So please mark your calendar for the remaining dates on the poster. We have some really interesting conversations on the horizon. The webinar series on human rights and reproductive justice grew out of the 2023 One Community, One Book selection, The Farm by Joanne Ramos. Told from the perspective of four women, The Farm explores key reproductive justice themes related to gender, race, and class, and who has access to power, freedom, and choice. So be sure to join us this Sunday, October 8th at 1:30 p.m. in the Pomerantz Center for a keynote by author Joanne Ramos. The Center is grateful for the 20 plus university departments and campus and community organizations that supported OCOB this year. We are particularly grateful for the collaboration of the co-directors of the Obermann Center's Working Group on Maternal Health and Reproductive Justice, Dr. Natalie Fixmer-Arias and Lina-Maria Murillo. Natalie Fixmer-Arias is the F. Wendell Miller Associate Professor of Communication Studies and an Associate Professor in the Department of Gender, Women's, and Sexuality Studies at the University of Iowa. Lina-Maria Murillo is an Assistant Professor in the Departments of History and also Gender, Women's, and Sexuality Studies. With gracious generosity, Lina and Natalie gave their time and expertise to the OCOB selection process and to envisioning and organizing this webinar series. It is with this in mind that I introduce and invite the moderator for today's Accessing Care webinar, Dr. Lina-Maria Murillo, to the screen. Professor Murillo received her doctorate in Borderlands History at the University of Texas at El Paso, UTEP in 2016. Where she also received her MA in 2011. Murillo earned her BA in History and Raza Studies from San Francisco State University in 2007. She is completing her manuscript titled Fighting for Control, Race and Reproductive Rights Activism in the U.S.-Mexico Borderlands, describing the clinics, organizations, and institutions that help to foster access to reproductive care along the border in the 20th century. This history reveals the tensions between advocates for population control and those committed to greater reproductive rights for the majority Mexican origin women in the region. The study focuses on the history of Planned Parenthood along the line and shines a light on the unknown history of abortion, population control, and Chicana activism that comprise the movement of the borderlands. Professor Murillo's full bio is on the UI Center for Human Rights website. So now, Lina, without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to your capable hands to introduce our panelists and launch the conversation.
Thank you so much, Joe. And I really would love to thank the University of Iowa Center for Human Rights for all of their collaboration and support in putting this together, and for the generous and wonderful support of my colleague Joe Butterfield, Erica Christensen, and of course Natalie Fixmar-Rise for dreaming up this series. We did it together and it was wonderful. So it is now my pleasure to introduce to you our panelists for today. I'm going to start with our very own Francine Thompson, who's the executive director of the Emma Goldman Clinic here in Iowa City. Her 36 years as an administrator of an independent, not-for-profit feminist care clinic that provides abortion care has given her extensive experience in reproductive health care management. She continues to be challenged and motivated with the unending assaults within the reproductive justice and abortion care movements. Her passion includes training students and volunteers and the next generation of feminists, healthcare providers, and activists. And also, if Francine can correct me if I'm wrong, the Emma Goldman Clinic is the longest running feminist clinic in the United States at this time, opened in 1973 and has not once shuttered its doors, and it's here in Iowa City. Our next wonderful panelist is Robin Marty. She's the director of operations for the West Alabama Women's Center, a former abortion clinic and current full-scale reproductive health center in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, a former freelance reporter on abortion rights and access. She's the author of the book, Handbook for a Post-Roe America, and quote, the new book for a post-Roe America, a guide for what to do when Roe is overturned and states make abortion illegal, and is the co-author of The End of Roe v. Wade. Robin's work is frequently published in Time Magazine, Cosmopolitan, NBC, The Guardian, Politico, and other news outlets. And she is a regular guest of MSNBC. And I've also been very fortunate to present along Robin Marty many, really once that was like right after Dobbs, and it was very emotional conversation with historians and legal scholars. And lastly, I am very excited and honored to present Melissa Upreti, is an internationally recognized human rights lawyer who has spent over two decades advancing gender equality and promoting accountability for human rights by using national, regional, and international law and mechanisms and engaging with governments and civil society. She has led mega research projects and fact-finding missions, undertaken strategic litigation, built the capacity of civil society organizations, and provided technical support to governments for legal and policy reform around the world. She holds law degrees from India and the United States, and her professional experience and activism span the globe. And truly, if you Google her name, she shows up in all the key sort of global conversations around human rights and reproductive health. She frequently lectures on women's rights and is widely published. She's also been interviewed on local and global news for her work on women's rights, including CNN, the BBC, and Al Jazeera. And she has been featured and quoted in a variety of print media. And I am humbled and honored to have you all here today to talk about accessing care. And I'm very excited to talk to you all because you are, sort of bringing us from this sort of regional, national, and then international perspective on accessing care. And I just want to start with a basic question for you all. When you hear the words access to care or accessing care, given your expertise, what comes to mind for you? Now, if we can start with Francine, and then Robin, and then Melissa.
Well, first of all, thanks for the invite to be a part of this panel. And I'm humbled by the other two panelists, and I'm excited to hear their perspectives on access. And I really thought, well, now this topic is so in my wheelhouse. It's not about legal stuff, right? So I answer the phones and I make appointments frequently at Emma, and I staff the lab, and I'm often in the recovery room on abortion provision day. So I feel like I hear regularly from clients about their challenges and barriers to accessing care. So I had my own ideas about what access meant, but I decided to go a little bit deeper and zoom out of the routine. And so I went to Webster's definition. And Webster says it's a permission, a liberty, or an ability to enter, approach, or pass to and from a place. It says it's a freedom or ability to obtain or make use of something. And those words, liberty and freedom, they really stuck out for me. They were so patriotic. I'm not sure that I use those words typically when I'm talking about access. And I'm really sure that our clients don't use those words. And what I hear clients talk about is much more practical. Get the appointment, get the money to pay for the appointment, and get a ride to the appointment. And with increasing restrictions, we abortion providers have needed to respond and react and really focus the majority of our resources in providing the care. And not everyone, but some of us were blindsided by the repeal of Roe. We were so busy complying with all the legal restrictions and working to minimize any access issues that were created by the restrictions. But as I continue to see clinics that provide abortion struggling to stay open, some being uprooted from their communities they were founded in and lived in. And when we talk about freedom and liberty and the ability to obtain abortion care and gender affirming care, and I zoom out a bit, it becomes less about whether you have money for services or a ride to the clinic if there isn't a clinic to go to. And more, that's what I think about when I hear the words access to care.
So first of all, Francine just sort of blew me away with the whole freedom and privilege and all of that. And it's really interesting to me because here I live now in Alabama, which is an entire region that does not have access. So we're talking from Texas all the way over to the panhandle of Florida. There are no clinics at this point. The nearest clinic for a person who is in my area of Tuscaloosa to be able to even get a abortion in the first 6 weeks would be Atlanta, which is 3 hours away. But that's only if you can get in there within like a week or so after you realize you're pregnant, and it's almost impossible. Florida is about to lose that ability to go up to 15 weeks. But even with that, for a person in Tuscaloosa, it would take probably 6 hours in one direction to drive to the nearest clinic that is actually open in Florida. So when we're talking about access for the South, we have to look at how does a person access abortion? And so I've been working really hard in my head to change my mindset on what abortion access looks like and also what Dobbs has done and what that means to my patients who are in our area. And access is information, and getting information out to people is how we can ensure that they still have the ability to get an abortion, even if they don't have the money, the resources, all of the other things they need in order to get this care. So what I'm trying to tell myself and how I'm trying to reframe this right now is that what if Dobbs is actually the best opportunity that could happen to people in the South when it comes to accessing abortion? Because if this information is available, abortion is actually easier for a person in a state like Mississippi, in a state like Alabama, in a state like Texas to access than it was prior to Dobbs. Because prior to Dobbs, you had to go into a clinic. You had to be sure that you had multiple visits. You had to have your time periods in between. It was extraordinarily expensive. And now, thanks to the introduction of shield laws, the ways that providers are now able to offer medications from safe states where they will not get in trouble for sending them to states like mine, where allegedly a person who manages their own abortion will not be charged, that creates a new perfect storm where suddenly it will come faster than when they had to order from overseas. It will be more regulated and you can know that you are taking the right kind of medication. So that is why access is information. And that is why you see states like Alabama, where I'm not supposed to be allowed to tell somebody that they can get medication online, that I'm not supposed to allow my staff to let people know that they could come in and check and make sure that everything was okay, because they are seeing that as a criminal conspiracy. So information access is where they're going to be cutting off next. And we have to figure out a way to make sure that the people who are in the most marginalized communities, the least accessible areas, are able to get this information, however it happens, but also through means that aren't always the internet or other resource heavy things that we don't know that people in rural areas will be able to get. So that's what access is for me right now.
Melissa, would you like to, yes.
Sure, thank you so much, Joe, Lina, for inviting me to be part of this really important discussion. And also Francine and Robin, it's such a pleasure to meet you online and to join you. I think for me as a human rights lawyer, the word access evinces a whole range of things, but I'll highlight a few. When I hear that word, I first think about health. When we talk about access to healthcare, I think of health as a human right and as something being tied to a person's dignity. It makes me think of the positive duty of the state of governments to ensure access. It's part of a package of things. Accessibility is tied to availability, affordability, the quality of services, as well as the acceptability of services. It reminds me of the duty of states to ensure the existence and smooth functioning of health systems so that all of these indicators can be met holistically, which means there must also be trained providers. There must be appropriate medication and facilities that are widely available. It also reminds me of the recognition that there are underlying determinants of healthcare access. So aside from the indicators that I just mentioned, things like proper sanitation, considerations of gender and gender dynamics, housing, a whole host of things, a range of infrastructure and socioeconomic conditions are also tied to access. The word also reminds me of the fact that there are so many barriers to access, right? Too many to name. Everything from, I mean, Francine and Robin mentioned some of them, but ranging from cost to distance, and also less tangible systemic barriers. So harmful gender stereotyping, the use of cultural and religious pretexts to deny access, systemic racism, even conscientious objection, which comes from providers. Oftentimes, these are barriers, and those who seek to access services have to grapple with so many of these things. And these barriers usually happen not, you know, one at a time in a linear fashion, but really often converge in a person's life. So I think just really, when I think about access, what stands out as most important, or a very important part of the conversation, is really the duty of the state and the roles of various institutions and actors, including public officials, and their responsibility to employ a range of means, such as legislative, executive, judicial, and financial, not to create access and to really remove these barriers, to create an enabling environment so that access is unencumbered and available to all of those who need it.
Thank you so much. And I think one of the things that this makes me think about in sort of this broader view, actually is a recent study that just came out. I think it was through Harvard that was looking at life expectancy in the US, and that somehow it peaked in like 2014. It's been sliding down, mainly because we don't have a form of sort of socialized healthcare. Healthcare costs are prohibitive in this country. And so I feel, you know, to quote Loretta Ross, for me, questions of access to reproductive healthcare are the tip of the iceberg underneath the sort of larger issue, right? It's the one that it's most easiest to see because it's so, you know, under attack consistently through legislatures. And so I wonder then if we can sort of talk about, you know, in the communities in which you're working, who seem to be the most devastated by these state denials of care, either by defunding care, right, or not funding it at all. And here I want us to think, if we can, very broadly, really using sort of a reproductive justice human rights lens, to include access to not just abortion, but contraception, maternal care, gender-affirming care, pre- and postnatal care, right? Like all of these things that really encompass reproductive health care. And I'll start in the opposite. Melissa, if you want to start from the global, I'll narrow it down.
Sure, thank you. So, you know, speaking from a global perspective, obviously there are so many different, I'll just say subgroups for lack of a better word, of women who are impacted in many different ways. And I think it's really important to use, in my work requires me to use an intersectional lens to really recognize the cumulative impact of all of these multiple, you know, and intersecting forms of institutionalized discrimination. And, you know, it really reveals where power and privilege lie, and also how structural causes and the low level of legal protection and guarantees of rights really create these, you know, variations in different subgroups. So some that I have found, you know, the most common ones, I would say, you know, among the many are, you know, low income women, right? Poor women across the world are disproportionately impacted and disadvantaged. Those who are employed in the informal sector and who typically have far less legal protection or social protection, and that includes a large number of migrant workers. Those involved in stigmatized professions, such as sex work, for example. Those who are displaced by conflict, violence, natural disasters. And, you know, there are so many different types of crises that cause displacement. And produce refugees, asylum seekers, again, who have fewer legal protections. For me, I think women under incarceration really stands out as a highly neglected group as well. Women who are homeless, again, somehow subsumed and less visible, but they are definitely impacted. Those groups that have historically suffered discrimination due to conquest, colonization, and institutionalized practices such as slavery, who even today bear the burden of its legacy. So in my work, I've also documented, for example, indigenous women and girls of African descent. Generally speaking, the majority of women in developing countries or the global south with a history of colonization, we have found described as being in a persistent state of crisis, actually, in relation to many of their sexual and reproductive rights. Those who are stereotypes based on their ethnicity, so Roma women, Dalit women, again, in different parts of the world. As a cross-cutting group, I think young girls and adolescents or who typically have less access to information, less financial independence, period poverty is an issue, again, going beyond abortion and contraception, one of the issues that they have to grapple with, and they're often subjected to even more intense stereotyping and prejudice about their sexual behavior, which makes things even worse. Again, thinking broadly, I think older women is a less discussed subgroup whose sexual and reproductive health issues are neglected and underfunded. We're just beginning to see menopause, for example, discussed more publicly, which also illustrates how a lot of reproductive health concerns, unless they are related specifically to procreation, are generally neglected. So I think the other context that deserves mention is just given how pervasive sexual violence is, which produces a higher risk of pregnancy and even sexually transmissible infections. Just being female is also a risk factor and a huge disadvantage, right? So I think we have to really understand how pervasive these problems are. And this can be compounded by domestic violence, which creates additional risks and barriers. So I think generally speaking, women as a class are disadvantaged by, you know, all of these vulnerabilities that are structurally, you know, have roots in structural causes. But, you know, all of this becomes even more intensified by lower levels of funding and the lack of prioritization in policy. And while those who have the means and who are more privileged can overcome many of these barriers, it's particularly devastating when they converge. And I think that's also important to remember that women are often not just dealing with one barrier, but multiple barriers and disadvantages.
I think it was really fabulous to listen to what Melissa said, because it made me realize how much everything that she said applies to here. These are international problems. These are problems. And so everything that you say, all of these protected classes, all of this colonialization, lack of sometimes I don't really know if I consider Alabama to be a developed country, to be completely honest. I mean, it sounds awful, but the way our infrastructures don't work, the way that we are basically in a climate crisis, the way that it can't rain without us worrying about flash floods and deaths. We are an undeveloped nation in some ways down here, and that's purposeful because that is what our government wants, particularly our legislature, because that is how those who are already elected will stay in power. They will stay in power as long as they can make sure that they are the only ones who are able to vote, are able to access healthcare, are able to access the good jobs, and that's how the system works down here. And also, I'm really sorry, I'm in Brooklyn for a thing, and so there's like construction noise everywhere. So it's terrible. Let me know if you can't hear me. But so all of those are all the exact same things that we are seeing here. One of the reasons why we made it our mission to stay and keep our reproductive health care center open, even though abortion was no longer legal, was because we understood that there was so little access to any sort of health care, much less sexual and reproductive health care in Alabama, that it was no different with abortion gone. People needed these things just as much, and people needed it in a way that was patient-centered and in a way that understood their community and their culture as well. We've seen a number of different groups that have come in here into the South recently, and they think they can fix things, and they want to fix things in the way that they believe will be fixing them. And it's very frustrating to me to find groups from, say, Massachusetts or New York or such who will come in and they're like, okay, well, how about we give you a whole bunch of money for IUDs? We want you to give everybody IUDs. And I have to try to explain to them, people don't want that. You are not going to find women in the South who want any form of birth control that cannot be controlled completely within their hand and that requires a doctor who has to remove it. And they're aghast that why would you not want the most effective thing? And so you have to go through this whole education. And then they're like, oh, well, if you're not going to accept what we want to offer, then we're not going to give you anything. That's horrifying to me. Like, we have a state that has not expanded Medicaid. We have a state in which most people are not able to get any form of preventative care. Most people have no private physicians. Most people have no access to any sort of low-cost clinics. There is nothing for a person to use. And so this is why we have a Medicaid system that if you do become pregnant, it is like a 1 in 3 shot that you're even going to get your Medicaid approval and get a doctor before you've made it into the second trimester. And these are all the things that we're trying to address with our free care and try to set up policies that we believe other people can follow. But our medical profession, especially in Alabama, is very white, very male, very patriarchal, and they believe that these things can all wait.
Robin, so much of what you said really resonated with me, and also Melissa, just in terms of really identifying those folks who are going to be most devastated by the by bans, state bans, and, you know, not to state the obvious for myself, but of course, BIPOC women and Black women specifically are the canaries in the coal mine. And for a complexity of reasons, health disparities exist. And, you know, we're disproportionately impacted by those disparities. Now, I was a rural state, and providing access to maternity care is a challenge in rural communities. And according to a 2010 study from Rayburn and colleagues, I was tied for 46th out of 50 states with 4.2 obstetricians per 10,000 women of reproductive age. And this should really be troubling, as less medical schools have the ability to provide training for family planning, including abortion. Some folks are deciding not to go to those schools, and so there will be even less OB-GYNs in our states. And according to a report by the Iowa Public Radio, the maternal mortality rate for pregnant non-Hispanic Black people in Iowa was 6 times higher than that for white individuals in 2020. But, you know, if Serena and Queen Bee aren't safe from potentially fatal maternal complications, then who is? And I haven't mentioned that, you know, sadly, we're seeing the teens, including, you know, trans teens that are being devastated by hateful and harmful legislation. I mentioned earlier that independent clinics are closing or relocating in other communities. And Robin mentioned this also, but we know that from Abortion Care Network's Communities Need Clinics report that when independent clinics close, they typically don't reopen. And those services that impact traditionally underserved populations are no longer available as a result of those closures. And here's some scary numbers. Since 2017, there have been 133 independent clinic closures, and 42 of those independent clinics closed in 2022. So, you know, I know that the South is a different animal, but, you know, they also say, as goes Iowa or something like that. And we're going down a dark hole for sure.
Which is complicated when they pass laws that restrict access to abortion and there are no mechanisms or infrastructures to support people who are now being forced into pregnancy. Right. It produces a slew of human rights issues. And I think Iowa, as Francine rightfully said, is such a fascinating place because people do have to, it's already a rural state. And I think that study that Francine quoted, I think it's even worse now. The maternal care deserts are just, we're awash in them here in Iowa. And from what I understand, at the medical school, students can opt out of learning about certain kinds of reproductive health care, for instance, abortion, and still leave medical school as licensed physicians, which to me seems highly problematic and frightening. If somebody comes in with a complication, let's say in an ER, and they have a physician who opted out of this kind of care, right? And we see this more and more. This is, you know, a way to uphold certain people's religious liberties in, you know, very particular group of people's religious liberties in the United States. And, you know, I guess this leads me in some ways to our next kind of question here. And I think, Robin, you alluded to it, right? Nonprofits and other organizations that, you know, aside from state regulations and policies, what are other barriers to care, right? That we don't often think of when we have these conversations that don't necessarily connect with governments.
In a lot of ways, and I need to make sure people understand that from my background, I only got into clinical care a couple of years ago when Yellowhammer Fund, which I was working for at the time, purchased the West Alabama Women's Center. So a lot of this has been very new to me, but as it has been very new to me, it's also been very eye-opening, especially when it comes to the way that for-profit healthcare is basically killing everyone in the country and nobody's addressing it. And even when you say, okay, well, here's a nonprofit system, no, nonprofit systems work in exactly the same way. The reality is that nonprofit, for-profit, whatever it is a money-making system. And because of that, it is so unbelievably dangerous to the people who have the least amount of means, especially, but to everyone as a whole, because it collapses hospital systems. It collapses the ability for people to be able to make it through training. It collapses everything. And one of the biggest shocks to me when I moved out here was when I found out that for people who don't have insurance in Alabama, and that's a lot of people out here, Medicaid covers basically if you have any income, you have too much money to get Medicaid. There's a slightly higher higher level once you are pregnant, but it's not high enough that we find a lot of people are still falling into the gap. And so they come in pregnant with no insurance, and they come to us for prenatal care because we do not charge for it if you don't have insurance, or we will charge a very minimal out of pocket. But in order to see another doctor in our healthcare system in Tuscaloosa, a person has to pay $2,000 up front in order to pre-book their prenatal care appointments, because doctors do not believe that they will be able to come up with the money as they go. And they want to make sure that they have their financials in order and on hand before they will actually give them care. So it's not legislators who are necessarily denying people care. It's not even the Supreme Court, it's the greed of the way our for-profit and even nonprofit medical system works, in this assumption that we need to make sure that there is a paying customer and that we get our money and that we are able to keep going. And I get it, because running a clinic is really damn expensive. And especially for private doctors, it is very expensive because our system is set up for private doctors to cost a lot, charge a lot, send it to the insurance company, who then will pay for it. And then they will charge a lot to the people who are getting insurance, who then pay for their premiums, but also then pay huge deductibles. And so it's all a way to make profit off of the individual patient. And we could cut all of the crap out of the middle of it and just have those individual patients do it straight to the end and not have to fund all the bureaucracy around it as well. But that I'm basically ready to rip the entire healthcare system down and try to rebuild it from scratch. But so it's money. It's always money. And it's, yes, there's racism. Yes, there's sexism. But the reality is that there are a lot of people in the medical profession that are not in the medical profession because they want to help people. They're in the medical profession because it's a job. And so if they are in an emergency room and there is a pregnant patient out in the emergency room who thinks she might be having an ectopic, but that OBGYN is done with his shift for the day, he's going to leave and tell her to watch and see if it gets more painful and come back tomorrow. That's what they do.
Okay, I think it's me. So, you know, then when I think about this, I think that time is a really is one of the large barriers to access. And as I get older, of course, time becomes more, you know, takes on different aspects and considerations as I'm getting a little older. But people really have busy schedules and demanding jobs. They've got numerous responsibilities. And this makes their time incredibly valuable. They're worried about how much time they're going to spend at the clinic and how long there is, you know, before an appointment's available, and what days and times are offered, and will that be enough time to have an abortion even in the first place, given the gestational ban. So, you know, time can really be this valuable commodity, and it's also a barrier when it comes to healthcare. And I think it's important for us to really work to recognize and address the time-related challenges in accessing and delivering healthcare services, because those are crucial for ensuring that everybody has timely access to the care that they need to maintain and improve their health. And I won't stay here long, but I think information is the other one. Whether it's misinformation or lack of information or the chaos about information that is clearly orchestrated and planned by the antis and the legislators. But it can be really challenging for folks in the movement to keep up with whether a law is enjoined or not, or if you need an ultrasound in Iowa, but not in Nebraska. And just about every place that you might call for an appointment will probably have a little different requirements or something different that's needed than the next place that you might call. So when you throw in language and cultural barriers, it becomes even more challenging, the information and the time piece. So information and time seem like barriers that we don't often think of, but that are really challenging.
Yes. Well, I can jump in now. And I think just to add to that, I completely agree from a global perspective as well. I think time, cost, are definitely major barriers, and information, especially misinformation. In addition to those, I mean, these things happen in a broader context as well, right? So I think just generally at a societal level, public-private sphere, in both public and private spheres, I think the harmful gender stereotyping and the construct of gender, the notion that women must perform certain roles in society at the expense of their autonomy and agency and freedoms. I think this really underlies a lot of the barriers and, sort of fuels them and almost helps justify and normalize them as well, right? So we are kind of forced to accept these. The misuse these are also embodied in culture and religious norms, which are misused. Now, I'm not criticizing culture, religion per se, but it's really the politicization of culture and religion, and then the justifications that are provided in order to impose these types of stereotypes and societal expectations. And then I think another piece that's missing or problematic is really that in many countries, the very premise underlying the provision of care, so the premise underlying laws, policies, and the health systems, there really lacks a human rights-based approach to healthcare, which means the recognition that by denying healthcare, you are really denying a person the ability to live with dignity and the ability to exercise many other rights, including their most basic civil and political rights, which are on the one hand often given importance, but the interrelatedness of all of these rights when it comes to women in the context of sexual and reproductive health care and sexual and reproductive rights is just not recognized. So their rights to life, equality, non-discrimination, privacy, even freedom from cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. I mean, these are rights that are implicated. And when we work, when we use international human rights law as a framework to look at these issues, we also talk about these rights as well. And then I'll just add, and I think Robin may have mentioned this, and maybe Francine too, really the direct opposition to sexual and reproductive rights, really direct opposition to abortion and contraception by political actors and right-wing groups working together who use these arguments, cultural and religious arguments, and feed those into law and policy. I mean, we shouldn't be governed by one particular religious ideology. Religion is a private matter, and we all have the right to practice our own religion. Once these ideologies are fed into laws, policies, and used to design our systems and structures, that's when it becomes oppressive. And these movements are active around the world. They're very well connected. They're very well funded, and they're driving the backlash against women's rights. I think the politicization of sexual and reproductive rights to roll back women's rights, it really represents the instrumentalization of women's bodies to advance a political agenda. And we're seeing this throughout the world.
Oh, thank you so much. And I am looking at the questions in the Q&A, and one of them matches the one that I was going to ask you. And so I'm going to bring up her question. And of course, it happens to my colleague, Natalie Fixmore-Rice. We all often find synchronicity in our thoughts. But she says that she's struck by the numerous barriers that have emerged in our conversation. And she's wondering what legal and or cultural shifts you would advocate if you could dream radically about what support and care would look like. And what, if anything, are you seeing on the ground that creatively challenges these legal restrictions? And she says, I realize we live in a time that is outrageously hostile to reproductive justice, gender justice, and bodily sovereignty. But even hearing where you would go if you could imagine something better, just to offer us some sort of a North Star. But and my question was very similar. You know, what have you seen on the ground? What are the sort of ingenious ways that people are subverting these barriers to care? Anyone can jump in at this point.
I'm trying to think of anything really. So I think that for some, it's difficult to understand that it's really complicated in the South to try to come up with really innovative ways to get around some of these things legally, because we're not just talking about, okay, this is a fine, this is a slap on the wrist. We're talking about being considered helping somebody to have an abortion is 99 years in prison in Alabama. So it's not a take this lightly sort of thing. By that means, I also believe that should anything happen, that the implications and the blowback would be really toxic and would be changing for the entire conversation. But nobody wants to be the test case. And that's one of the things that I always try to make people understand is this is an area, like if our doctor somehow was thrown in jail, there's no trans care anymore in Western Alabama. If somebody tries to, there's just the implications of how much impact some of the people who could challenge things, like taking them out of the picture would be. One of the reasons why we follow the conspiracy rule that we were told by the attorney general is because in my clinic, everybody who works with me is a single Black woman, single mother. And so to have those be the people who could potentially end up in jail, that's just not a thing that I can risk. And so we'd love to be able to see, I will tell you my dream scenario. And my dream scenario is that all of the full of themselves pop stars and actors and everybody who's like, I really want to do something to change abortion laws, I want them all to get together, and I will even offer to organize it. They all get together and they all say, I'm going to come down and I'm going to do medication abortion in Alabama. And this is the day I'm going to do it. And I'm going to bring my pills, and anybody who shows up, I will hand them out to you. Because if anybody is going to risk 99 years in jail and have the resources to be able to fight that, it's the Alyssa Milanos and the Matthew McConaughey's and all of those. So they are the ones that I want to have come down here and say, okay, I'm just going to hand out abortion pills. Because the reality is any person can be an abortion provider. At this point, because medication abortion is so safe, it does not matter who is the person who actually hands it in a box to you. And so I want those people with those resources to come down to Texas, to come down to Alabama and be the ones to challenge, because they have the privilege and the ability.
So I'm going to be real honest with you that and why I hesitated to answer. You know, at one time I thought Roe v. Wade was the answer. And then at one time I thought the FDA approval of Mifeprex would change access to abortion. And it has. It really has. But not in the way we envisioned. We thought that we could just call our doctor up and get it. And that hasn't happened. And at one time I thought that increased health insurance access, Obamacare, would increase access to healthcare. But increasing insurance access doesn't necessarily increase access to care. And so I'm not sure that I have any really ingenious ideas, or I'm watching what lots of other folks who are much more creative than me and are faced with some of these issues are doing. And if I'm able to, you know, move them into, you know, our scenario and circumstances, then we're going to try whatever it takes to be more efficient, to make our services more accessible. And of course, in an ideal society, you know, with reproductive justice and human rights framework, healthcare would be comprehensive and equitable, you know, with a wide range of care and services for all communities. And isn't that the dream?
Yeah, I think from what I would say, this is a huge question, but I think one thing that is fundamentally needed is a shift away from patriarchal values to one that recognizes more fully women's agency and autonomy, or individual agency and autonomy. And maybe in a more concrete sense, what this would entail, among other things, is really the provision of universal access to a full range of affordable sexual and reproductive health information, goods, and services for all with compassion, without judgment or stigma. And this will require many structural and attitudinal shifts, I understand, but that is one ideal that sort of comes to mind. In terms of how this may be achieved or what has made a difference, when I look at the world, and just to give you a few examples, I think, and also speaking as a lawyer, hoping to inspire maybe some of the lawyers and also allies, because we lawyers cannot do this alone. I mean, no one person or one group of people can engineer these shifts alone. But I think things that have made a concrete difference in the world include things like, you know, fact-finding, documentation of real harms, and, you know, the publication of reports. I know this sounds very, you know, no one wants to read another report, maybe, or work on another report, but, you know, the analysis that really examines the harms and makes the connections to laws, policies, and structures, and then, you know, also, which includes a comparative legal analysis to see how other countries are addressing similar issues. So learning from or being inspired by how others are addressing these problems, because we're not the only ones. And then using that in advocacy and calling for structural change, legal and policy reform, as well as, you know, strategic litigation has been very impactful in a number of countries. I know, especially in the US, one may also, it's overwhelming. The whole situation is overwhelming. But for example, I originally am from Nepal. I came to this country about 24 years ago. When I left Nepal, it had a criminal ban on abortion. Now, Nepal has one of the most liberal abortion laws in the world. There is a general prohibition. There's still language generally prohibiting it, but it is legally permitted on several grounds. And how was this achieved? Over a period of, I would say, maybe 15 years, there were, you know, all of these strategies were undertaken, different movements worked together. But I think what really sort of tipped things was, and this is my final point in relation to what can make a difference, I think it's public outrage. There has to be public outrage, condemnation. Years ago, more than two decades ago in Nepal, when I think it was a 14 or 15 year old girl was thrown into prison for having an abortion. Actually, she was formally charged with the crime of infanticide. And this was someone who, you know, was a minor and who had, who became pregnant after being, after being raped. She was charged with infanticide, thrown into prison for life. And this one case created such public outrage that helped create a context where then a lot of other things came together, and there was, I think a collective recognition that this had to change, that criminalizing abortion, if it's going to produce this kind of an outcome, is totally unacceptable and change is needed. So I think public outrage is probably one of the things that we haven't seen enough of, but, you know, hopefully we will, and people can express their outrage in a number of ways, you know, through the power of the vote, by speaking out, by coming together, working across movements. And I think that is something that will make a difference. Thank you.
Thank you. And we just have a few seconds left. And I am looking at this great question by Andres Restrepo Sanchez, who asks, how influential has reproductive justice been in transforming legislation in the US and other countries? Or just like also just transforming, I would add to that, our conversation, the way we talk about access. And we have 5 minutes, Joe's telling me.
Sure, if I may jump in very quickly, I think something that you said in the beginning, I think it may have been Joe or Lina, but how the reproductive justice framework was also inspired by international human rights. Standards, the, you know, participation of women from the United States in the International Conference on Population Development, the engagement that they had with women from around the world, and after they came back, you know, how they thought about the issues based on the realities on the ground. Then the human rights framework has been a very effective tool in bringing about change, because it really captures so many different dimensions. And it also establishes very clearly what the obligations of the state are, and helps one make the connections between the harms, individual harms, the systemic drivers of those harms, and then accountability, right? What's the point of talking about rights if there's no recourse, no accountability? So I think that's one thing that has proven to be very useful and helped bring about major shifts in many different countries.
I think reproductive justice as it is applying in the South, especially in Alabama right now, it may not have had any sort of impact on legislation or how things work that way, but it has had a major impact on how our organizational work has become, how our groups, Alabama, like Southern organizations aren't like Northern nonprofits. Southern organizations come out of people who say, you know, I need this thing and I can't get it. And also I have a friend who needs this thing and they can't get it. So I guess we're going to have to organize a thing in order to figure out how to get it. And so that's how grassroots organizations and grassroots organizing happens in the South. And so the way that we have been able to grow our networks in order to make sure that we are meeting maternal health care needs, that we are meeting economic needs for people, that we are finding safe housing, that we are working on houselessness, that we are working on education, that we are doing trans care, that we are bringing all of these things together, that in itself and the way that it has allowed our groups to work with each other and understand how to support each other, that's how reproductive justice is working for us.
Francine, I think you have the last word.
Oh, so when I think about how conversations and how reproductive justice framework has had impact in the work that I personally do and with other reproductive and movement organizations in the state and regionally, I think it's how we talk about things and that it's changed how we talk about things, and it's become much more inclusive. You know, even though we do a lot of things at the Emma Goldman Clinic and always have, it's still primarily an abortion provider, and that's what folks center on. And so when we talk about it from a reproductive justice framework, then we add in some folks who may not feel as strongly about abortion. And so it really has the potential to increase the folks that we're able to bring into the tent, so to speak, but we still got a long ways to go.
And I cannot believe we ran out of time so quickly, but I am so thankful for this conversation today, and I hope that we can continue to network and to have these conversations together. And for folks who have been participating, thank you so much for joining us, and feel free to reach out to us to continue these conversations or ask questions. I think that we are very much, all of us on the screen, if I can speak for us, that we're all committed to reproductive justice as a praxis and a framework. And so part of that is communicating with people. So thank you again. I pass it to Jo.
So, oh gosh, thank you to today's panelists and Lina for taking time out of your extraordinarily busy schedules to share your expertise and your insights and to give us some things to think about. Thanks too to today's webinar attendees for supporting the center's programming and for your interest in the integral relationship between reproductive justice and human rights. Special thanks to my wonderful colleague, UICHR's program manager, Erica Christensen, for her always impeccable behind the scenes work on our webinars. So please mark your calendars to join us for the next webinar in the Human Rights and Reproductive Justice series on outcome disparity. And we touched on this issue off and on throughout this entire webinar. As was mentioned, maternal death rates in the US have doubled in the last two decades. And indeed, the US currently has the highest maternal death rate among high-income nations. And the webinar, our next webinar on the 25th, will be moderated by my colleague, UICHR's Assistant Director, Amy Wiseman, and will examine the complex factors that contribute to the stark disparities within the bleak maternal outcomes trend. We're gonna hear from folks who research and study and work towards improving better and more equitable maternal outcomes and the role that the promotion and protection of human rights can play in doing so. You'll be able to find today's program as well as all of our previous webinars on the UICHR YouTube channel. And you can stay up to date about center programming by joining our mailing list and following us on social media. And finally, if you enjoy today's webinar and you want to contribute to the center's ability To sustain this kind of quality programming, please consider establishing a monthly recurring donation by visiting our website. Recurring donations of even $10 per month can make a big difference. So thank you to the panelists and to our attendees, and I hope you all have an amazing day. Thank you.